2, 3, 4, 5.
Nice. Okay. Okay, good. Sounding great. No. Yay for my fans!
Welcome to Harbor Talk. Each week, I bring on a guest and introduce three taboo topics in 3 minutes. Before the show, I cook the guest breakfast. After the show, the guest and I usually talk about those topics in depth.
My next guest is Salisa Kalackel.
Salisa!
Hello!
Hello! Are you ready to be on Harbor Talk today?
I'm so excited.
Amazing.
I'm so ready.
Oh, me too. It's going to be so much fun. Okay? We are starting the timer in 3, 2, 1. So what's the first thing that you want to talk about today?
The first thing I want to talk about is what post-grad life is like.
Okay. Now, why do you believe that's a taboo topic?
Well, in college, no one really tells you what it's like when you leave college. They tell you about what it's like to find jobs and, like, you know, how to, you know, work professionally and things like that. But they don't tell you about, like, the social and personal aspect. Like, how do you make friends when you're out in the adult world? Like, how do you build a life for yourself? How do you deal with, like, the loneliness? The loneliness is probably the worst part that people don't talk about. And as someone who moved to a city where, like, I only knew, like, one person, which is you, and I didn't know anything about the city I was living in, it was really hard, and it still is kind of hard to kind of adjust. I've had a hard time making friends. I think I only just started making friends, like, a couple months ago, and yeah. I've been here for, like, 6 months already, and I didn't realize that making friends in the adult world is nothing like college. You know, you don't have a built-in community to, like, pick and choose friends from. You kind of have to put yourself out there and, like, make a very conscious effort to make friends, and that's something I did not know when I first got out into the world. And making friends in the adult world is kind of like dating almost, which makes me feel kind of weird. Like, you have to actually schedule hanging out with them. You have to, like, actually, like, make an effort to make plans. It's not like college where, you know, your friends live, like, a couple feet away from you, or they live, like, in a dorm building, like, across campus that you can walk to. It's not like that anymore. You have to, like, meet up at a coffee shop first and then, like, build a friendship that way. And I didn't know that. So now I'm starting to learn and starting to adjust. But the loneliness part is really hard, too. Like,
sure.
Being away from all your friends and having it be a situation where your only contact with them is through, like, FaceTime and calling them and texting them. That's really hard. Shout out to all my friends who answer all my calls all the time.
100%.
I love you. But that's really hard, and I didn't know that at all. So there's been a lot of times where I felt super lonely. Like, I felt like I didn't have any friends. I felt, like, really lost, too. I think that's something that doesn't get discussed in post-grad world is
sure.
Even if you have a job, even if you, like, are living somewhere and, like, making money, you can feel really lost, and, like, you can feel like, you know, you're, like, it's like you're floating out in the sea, right? Mm-hmm. And you feel like you're kind of, like, drowning, so you're trying to tread water.
Sure.
But you're, like, only just above water.
Right.
That's kind of how post-grad life feels.
100%. It's very relatable.
Yep.
I know I felt that way, even as I've had some high school friends that live here. That's been something that I've been accepting, though, is to be comfortable with the loneliness. It's not easy. Don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
And especially considering someone who doesn't live in this city, it makes it even more of a different experience, wouldn't you say?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And when I first moved here, I did kind of embrace the loneliness at first. And I was like, I'll go explore the city on my own and it'll be great. And it was for, like, definitely, like, a few weeks or, like, my first month. But then after that, it kind of dies down and I was like, okay, well, now I want to spend my time with, like, other people.
Sure.
So that's been hard too.
Sure.
And I think also, like, yeah, you feel really lost.
Of course.
Super lonely.
Yeah.
And you have to learn how to, like, be by yourself, which, like, I'm still learning.
Mm-hmm.
And I've spoken to people who are older who, you know, they're, like, maybe 2, 3, 4 years out of college.
Mm-hmm.
And I asked them, like, did you also go through the same thing? Like, was your first year out of college really hard? And all of them were like, yeah, it's really hard. Mm-hmm. Like, it's kind of like growing pains almost.
Right.
And you don't realize it because when you're like a senior in college and you're about to graduate, like a lot of seniors are right now, you're like, you're really scared, or you could be like, oh, I'm so ready to graduate. Like, I'm done with college. I'm so ready to get out into the world and like be an adult. And that's a great feeling. And I definitely felt that way. But then when you actually get there, like, not to be a downer on all this college seniors out there, but honestly, like, it's not what you expect. Like, it's not all like sunshine and roses. Like, most of the time it's really, really hard. Like, the amount of times I've like just cried because I felt like so like down and like like got lonely and lost. Like, no one really prepares you for that. I don't think anyone can really prepare you for that, like, outside of just telling you that it's going to be really hard.
Right.
But no one told me it was going to be as hard as it's been.
Sure.
Yeah.
Right. Well, what's the second topic you want to talk about today?
The second topic I want to talk about is my favorite thing about myself.
Oh, yeah. That's so interesting. What about that do you think is taboo?
I think in general, for me, and I know for, like, a lot of people, it's hard, I think, to talk about ourselves. Like, when I write cover letters for jobs, I have such a hard time because I feel uncomfortable like bragging about myself. And I think it's something that is a bit gendered too. I think women are like kind of conditioned in a way to like definitely make themselves smaller and to not like talk about their like positive attributes like in a very confident way, as men do. And there are like a lot of studies that show this too. And I've talked to people who are reading cover letters, and they'll read cover letters by men, and they're very like aggressively confident in a good way. They'll say things like, I know I can do this, like, I'm really good at this. And then when women write cover letters, it's like, I was really fortunate enough to like get to do this, like like using language that isn't as aggressive, but it's more like, not timid, but I guess soft in a way. So I always feel like I don't know how to like talk about myself in such a positive way, because I was always kind of taught to like make myself smaller.
Right.
And especially I'll like say good things to myself, like positive affirmations, like, oh, you're great, you look really nice today. But it's hard to do that with other people.
Right.
Like, Luke, like, I'm super great.
Right.
Like, that feels so weird to me.
Right. To share a confidence with someone else is almost taboo, because it's like you're coming off as arrogant. You're coming off as maybe a little pompous.
Right.
But it's so wonderful when you can say, I feel great and I want you to feel great too, because I know you are great too.
Yeah.
It's sharing it, but it's hard to do that. We're not really taught how to do that, are we?
Exactly. Yeah. We're not taught how to do that. And especially like, for women, when we do like find that confidence and we share it, oftentimes it's like, oh, she like is kind of bitchy, or like she's cold, or she like oh, like she's full of herself. I hate that, because I see men all the time who are like so confident in their abilities, and then, you know, you have a woman that's doing the same thing, and then all of her, you know, peers around her or her coworkers are like, oh, like, I don't like her, like, she's like arrogant, or she's too cocky, like, I don't want to talk to her, which is like ridiculous.
It totally is ridiculous. Huh.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Damn, that's a perspective I've honestly never thought of.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So I guess if I were to talk about my favorite thing about myself.
Yeah, what would you say? What's yours? What's your favorite thing about yourself? And you own it. You own it.
I think I'm a very like loyal and kind person. Mm-hmm. So I think
that I can vouch for that.
In the friendships and relationships that I have, I always give like 100% effort. Like, I'm always going to listen to my friends if they like need to talk to me, or like they're having a tough time.
Mm-hmm.
I love giving advice to people.
Mm-hmm.
And like, I love listening. I just love listening to my friends too, and like talking to them. And I would do anything for my best friends. Like, if anyone ever wrongs them, I will find you.
Don't do it.
But yeah, I'm a very loyal person, and I know like the people in my life that I'm going to be loyal to, and I think that's a very strong trait of mine.
Oh, that's wonderful. And again, I can vouch for this. It's very true. It's amazing.
Thanks.
And what is the third topic that you want to tackle today?
I would like to talk about casual sex.
Okay. Tell me more.
Okay. So this is kind of inspired by an article that I read last week by Ella Dawson. And the headline is, we need to stop calling it casual sex. And the premise of the article, which I 100% agree with, is, so we have this concept of casual sex, right? Like, in there is one-night stands, like, you know, hookups, mm-hmm. friends with benefits, mm-hmm. like, whatever comes to mind, right? The problem is that there's, like, no level of, like, care there, because when you think about casual sex, it's kind of, like, the antithesis or kind of, like, the opposite of, like, romantic sex, like, as in sex when you're in a relationship with someone. And so that means, like, oh, like, you can't care about the other person, which is so ridiculous because sex, no matter how you see it, is a very intimate act. Like, even if it's with someone who you're only hooking up with once, right, you're still sharing a very intimate part of yourself with them. Like, it doesn't matter how well you know them or how well you don't know them. And the problem is that women are having bad sex because of this. The amount of, like, stories I've heard of women who are, like, they hook up with a guy and they just, like, they don't care about their pleasure at all. All they care about is, like his own personal pleasure. And so right. the woman comes away with it feeling like just unsatisfied.
Sure.
Which is not the goal of sex. The goal of sex is to feel good about yourself and to feel satisfied and to feel good about sharing, like, a fun experience with the other person,
right,
regardless of the relationship. And so I really like the piece because it was saying no matter what kind of sexual relationship it is, if it's, like, you know, just, again, a one-night stand or, like, a hookup that you're not, like, romantically involved with,
mm-hmm.
you have to care about them. You have to show them a level of, like, human respect and decency. You have to, like, and this, honestly, like, this is going out to a lot of men because, like, it's mainly men who do this. You have to care about how the other person feels. You have to care about, you know, their pleasure, like, how they're doing. You have to check in and be like, hey, is this okay? Like, are you having a good time? Like,
right.
What do you want me to do that makes you feel good?
Right.
And we need that in sex. Like, you need to communicate. You need to ask questions. You need to check in. And it's so ridiculous that casual sex posits that you shouldn't do those things.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing, too, is I think this happens on college campuses a lot. You'll hear people be like, oh, whatever, I hooked up with a guy last night, mm-hmm. or I hooked up with this girl last night. And then they'll see them on campus, right? And it'll be awkward. They're like, oh, I can't say hi to them. Like, yeah. I can't make eye contact. Which is so ridiculous. Like, you had sex with them.
Right.
Like, you saw them naked. And you're not even gonna, like, give them the human decency of saying, like, hi, how's your day? Like, hi, how are you doing?
Right.
It doesn't make any sense. And that also ruins sex. Because, first of all, we should all be kind to each other and all, like, you know, be respectful of each other.
Mm-hmm.
And then, but you're not gonna, like, say hi or, like, give a smile or, like, a nice hello to the person that you were having sex with?
Sure.
That doesn't make any sense to me.
And it's understandable. The only thing I, just to put it on the table and also be open with you, is a lot of men don't know how to really be emotionally vulnerable and respectful within those casual sex relationships because they're taught that in some ways that it's a game. I'm gonna call my own self out. I had my phase in college where that was literally, I thought that the number of people I slept with determined who I was,
mm-hmm.
which is awful, but it's just the truth. And that idea of not saying hi to someone, because I did it many times, again, I did it many times in college, it came from a deep insecurity of, oh, no, that person was just a one-night stand and doesn't have a backstory that I don't want to get to know.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm too insecure to really go deeper with what that connection is. I'm trying to block myself out of that connection.
Yeah.
It's awful. I totally agree with that.
Yeah.
It needs to be better discussed. I mean, right. Men need to have better tools and really need to be sat down with and need to understand that it's okay mm-hmm. to not make it awkward. It's just really right. hard for some men, from what I understand.
Right. And the other thing, too, is I think casual sex implies that there's no emotion involved.
Right.
But there always
there's always is, emotion involved.
Yeah.
And the more you block it out, that's really unhealthy.
Exactly.
That's very damaging to your psyche.
Yeah. And it doesn't matter if, like, you're just having sex with, like, a really good friend and or you're having sex with someone you just met. Like, there's emotion involved. Like, it doesn't, like, clearly you chose, like, or you at least wanted to, you know, do this thing with them.
Right.
So why wouldn't you be kind and, like, make sure that they're having a good time? And then
right.
after, when it's over, and, like, you see them around, like, why wouldn't you say hi to them? Like, why wouldn't you be, like, a nice person to them? Why would you...
What a crime to be a nice person.
Yeah, like, why would you ignore them?
Right.
Especially, like, if you had this experience and, like, it was good, like, why would you treat another person that way? Like, it's so... It seems so, like, indecent to me.
Fair enough. It's a very good point. Well, it's Lisa... Thank you so much for being on Harbor Talk today. That was amazing. Woo! Thank you all very, very much for watching Harbor Talk today. If you would like to submit a taboo topic, please follow me on Instagram at lharbor. I would love for you to join in on the conversation. Cool. And now we've got the end slate. You ready?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Salisa,
yes.
Are you ready for the end slate?
I'm ready.
Pause, play, try to be kind,
and
keep making a difference. We'll see you guys soon. Salisa, we've got Harbor Hot Takes for you today. Are you ready for three ridiculous questions?
Yes, I'm ready.
Great. From Matt Hornick, spiciest Lakers hot take.
LeBron James cannot and should not be tasked with carrying an entire team on his back.
Nice, you're right. Should men be canceled permanently?
Yes.
Nice. Number three, what is the worst Netflix show you've watched while a dude tried to chill?
One time, this is not a Netflix show, one time my guy put on a Chiefs game and tried to chill with me. This was before I knew anything about the Chiefs, so I did not understand the hype. I understand it now and I love the Chiefs, but he tried to do that and it wasn't working.
Rethink your priorities. Thanks for watching.